Welcome to Healthitarian Living. My name is Evita Ochel, and joining me today is special guest Burke Lennihan. Hello, Burke.
Hi, Evita.
Wonderful to have you, Burke, and I will share with the audience that Burke is a Harvard graduate, a registered nurse, and certified classical homeopath. She began studying homeopathy professionally in 1995 with Dr. Luc De Schepper, and co-founded the Renaissance Institute of Classical Homeopathy. She has created several written and video resources and currently practices at the Lydian Center for Innovative Medicine in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and is the author of the newly released book, Your Natural Medicine Cabinet, A Practical Guide to Drug-Free Remedies for Common Ailments. And that, of course, is going to be the main focus of our talk today and getting your expertise on how much we can do in natural alternative ways that can help us avoid the pharmaceutical approach that can often so greatly imbalance our body. So Burke, to begin with, you of course had such an amazing career in the field of natural health. And to add to that, you even owned a health food store for 16 years. Can you just give the audience just a little brief introduction as to why this has become such an integral part of your healing practice?
Because when I had my health food store, it was a very small store, and I was at the cash register all day long, right at the supplement section, and I was very curious as to what people were buying. And the store was so small, I had to really consolidate what I had. If a new product came out, I had to get rid of one of the old ones. So I wanted to really focus on what works the best. And I was constantly asking my clients what was working for them, why they were taking it, what results they were getting. And I have to say, I probably had one of the most intelligent clienteles or customer bases of any health food store in the country. First, I was on Beacon Hill in Boston, right down the street from Mass General Hospital. I had a lot of people from the hospital coming in. And then I moved it to Cambridge, right near Harvard Square. So many of my clients were Harvard students, Harvard faculty members, Harvard grads. So these were really, really smart people. So I was always asking them, especially if somebody special ordered something, you know, I diplomatically asked them, I'd say, do you mind my asking what you're getting that for, why you like it better than what I have on hand, how you can tell that it's working. And one of the conclusions I came to after many years of this was that much as I love vitamins, I believe in vitamins, I think people definitely need vitamins, it was interesting that people generally can't feel vitamins working. And the same thing, herbs are great. Herbs definitely have an effect, but they work slowly, let's say, if you're trying to get rid of a cold or something. But the people who bought the homeopathic remedies would say, as soon as I put the pellets in my mouth, I feel different. In fact, sometimes people, just to show me, they would open the tube right at the checkout counter. It might be like somebody who is in some kind of pain, whether it's a toothache or menstrual cramps or something, or a headache. And this would always happen, of course, but often enough that it really piqued my interest, you know, that somebody would put these little tiny pellets in their mouth, and then immediately they would feel different. And people would tell me these stories, like of babies screaming with teething pain. And we kind of think that probably the placebo effect is not going to work with babies. And they would put this little pellet of Highland's teething tablets, one of the most popular homeopathic remedies, and pop it into the baby's mouth. The baby would just take a big, like a big deep breath and fall asleep, calmly and peacefully fall asleep. And so I thought there must be something to this. But while I had my health food store, it felt like there's like this huge, big thing to learn about homeopathy. The Latin names of the remedies, it was confusing that for each problem, like a cold, there might be different remedies, but for each remedy, like arsenicum, it would do a lot of different things. It was seemed so overwhelming, I couldn't possibly master it while I had my store. But then when I turned 40, I thought, the store was getting to be physically really too much. I had, my storage was in the basement. I was always lugging 50-pound sacks of brown rice and these big boxes full of quart bottles of juice up and down the stairs. It was getting really tiring. And sadly, it was a time when people were discovering these discount vitamin stores. And so they'd come in, they'd interrogate me, they'd ask me all these questions, and they'd go buy this stuff in a discount store, which was, I just want to say to the audience, if you have a local independent health food store, please, please, please support your local independent health food store. It's such a good source of information, such a good community networking place. Mm-hmm. Keep your money in the local economy. Anyway, my store was not doing well financially. I was getting tired, and I thought, I want to do something as a holistic healthcare professional.
Yes.
And at the same time, I went to hear this talk by Dr. Luc De Schepper, who later became my teacher. He was speaking about homeopathy, and he brought up a concept that immediately made sense to me that I had never heard before. It made the hair stand up on the back of my head. He was talking about the concept of the never well since. And that means when someone has a chronic illness, you can ask them, what was the biggest stress in your life when this started? And you will get the stories of the husband leaving the wife for the best friend, or the teenage son killed in a drunk driving car accident, or people losing all their money in the stock market, or something, or the child who developed tics, for example, after being humiliated over and over again by a soccer coach or something. There was always something. I mean, and what he said was that the emotional, energetic underpinning of physical illness is so powerful, not always, but in many cases, that if you can resolve that, if you can like reach into the person's being and resolve the emotional and energetic trauma that they suffer, that the person is then expressing as a physical illness, you can actually dissolve the physical illness. I said, oh my God, this is putting everything together. And I just became like so passionately interested in homeopathy. And the idea that he would tell us story after story from his practice, major chronic illnesses diagnosed by major conventional medical centers, where the person would be told, you have to be on this drug for the rest of your life. Instead, they go to a homeopath. They get a homeopathic remedy for a year, maybe 2 years. Not only would this chronic illness somewhat magically disappear, it looks like magic, it's actually following scientific laws. It's a different science, but it's following scientific laws. Not only would the illness go away, at which point the doctor would say, well, it was either a misdiagnosis or a spontaneous remission. That's all they can say. But not only that, but the person would change. They would let go of their grief. Yeah. They would change their relationships with the people around them. Their creativity would come out. They would be sleeping better. They'd have better energy. I was hearing all these stories from Dr. Luc De Schepper, and I said, this is what I want to study. I was 42 years old when I heard this lecture. I thought, I really found my reason to be on this planet. I found what I want to do with my life. I found my life work. I found my life mission. I found my teacher. And that was the beginning of my study of homeopathy.
Beautiful to hear. Yeah. And, you know, I can't second enough what you also mentioned about supporting the local natural health food store. Because really, and that's really what healthitarian living is all about too, is not just eating locally, but living as much in that community atmosphere as possible. Now, when it comes to your book, of course, this is, as I recommend in the written review, which the audience can find on evolvingwellness.com, the book is just a gem, a true gem, because you really touched upon so many common ailments that people face today, you know, like arthritis or joint pain, muscle pain, back pain, etc., which so many people, of course, are dealing with, to sort of so many of those things that parents have to face on a regular basis with kids, to women's health. You outlined so beautifully the idea of going in, as you've just been mentioning, to the root of the issue on an emotional, mental, and physical level. And then, of course, leading people into the different remedies possible, but have a special place about homeopathy. Now, this, again, is an area that I feel so many people are in the dark about. Can you tell us, Burke, how can the average person understand what is homeopathy, really?
Well, it's a system of medicine that was developed 200 years ago. It's used in many countries around the world. It's actually part of the national healthcare system in many countries, in Western Europe and South America, India. India is the foremost. There are like 100 homeopathic hospitals, wow, homeopathic medical schools, doctors given full training, like the same length of training as doctors here, and they're trained as homeopaths. Anyway, so it's a system of medicine. The medicines come in the form of tiny little sugar pellets. And what they do is they contain information. And my favorite comparison is that they're like a little flash drive. I have a tiny little flash drive here. I'm going to hold it up. I just got this at Staples. It says tiny little thing. But you can put many gigabytes of information on this tiny little thing. So when you think about it that way, it makes more sense that a tiny little sugar pellet could actually contain a tremendous amount of healing information. The science is still being done. The research is still being done as to exactly how that information is stored. And let me say, it's not being done by homeopaths. We're not physicists. We're not chemists. It's actually commercial, industrial chemists and physicists. They're looking at information storage and looking at how water molecules can be arranged in patterns. You think of a snowflake. No two snowflakes alike, right? All different patterns. But they're all water molecules. They're all simple little water molecules in different patterns. And in the water of a homeopathic remedy dilution, what we now know, what we're discovering, is that there are crystal-like formations starting to form among water molecules. And with different starting substances, the crystalline formation is different. And somehow there's information being stored there that's transmitted to the body's healing energy. somehow by touching wet mucous membranes, the information is transmitted to the water in the body. Our bodies are mostly water. What happens inside the body is more of a black box. We don't understand how it works. But the fact is, if you look in the PDR, which is a physician's desk reference for drugs, many, many drugs, it will say mechanism of action unknown. So it's true of drugs as well. And people are comfortable flipping a light switch and the electricity goes on the light. How many people can explain how that works? We were just talking about the fact we both have Macs. Can we explain how our Macs work? No, but we use them. I like people to get to the point. What I'd like to do is introduce homeopathy in a really simple and effective way so people start using it and they just feel comfortable with it. And if it works for baby, as I mentioned, or cats and dogs are great to experiment on at first. If you're not comfortable experimenting on your kids, homeopathy works great for animals. And you don't have to worry about there's no placebo effect. You can find it in the health food store. I have a couple of samples here. I'll hold them up. Mm-hmm. The technical term for this is blue tube. This is what everybody calls it. The name of the company is B-O-I-R-O-N. Nobody can pronounce it, so we call it the blue tube. And then this is another very common company standard process. But you can hear these little pellets in here. They dissolve in the mouth very easily. Kids love to take them. One of the many, many benefits of homeopathy, advantages. Kids right. love to take them. They'll ask for their, how many kids ask for their regular drug? They ask for their yes. homeopathic medicine.
Because so, is it true that they have no taste really, right? Or if anything, maybe a little sugar residue?
It's like sugar.
Sweet, yeah.
Because sugar stores the information somehow as well as water does, and it's a very efficient way of transmitting them, a very, very efficient way of storing them.
Now, is there any concern for ingesting sugar in this case?
The pellets are very tiny. I get pellets from a company called Natural Health Supply, which I really recommend in my book. The pellets are so tiny, they're smaller than a grain of sand. So in that case, the amount of sugar is minimal. Right. When you get them from the health food store, the pellets are either from this company, they look like a baby aspirin. From this company, they look like a BB shot or a very small pea. So if you were to ingest a lot, yes, there is some sugar involved. So there's a very easy way around that, which is that you dissolve a pellet in about 4 ounces of water and stir it really well. And then one small sip becomes a dose. Now, if people absolutely cannot ingest any sugar, there's another way to take it. You take the water, you can rub it on the temples, on the inside of the wrist, dab it on the lips, so you're not actually swallowing it. Mm-hmm. Let's say we use them right before surgery. People have been told they can't eat anything before surgery because if you swallow something, you could vomit it up. Anesthesia, terrible. So a standard thing before surgery is, it's called nothing in the mouth. And yet there are homeopathic remedies that help prevent bruising, swelling, soreness, pain after surgery. They promote healing the incision. We want people to use them. So what we recommend is, you can swish like a mouthwash. All it has to do is touch the mucous membranes. Mm-hmm. So if people are very strict about the sugar, then there are ways around it.
Well, fantastic to know about that. But generally, everything that I've learned from your book and even from other sources about homeopathy, really the sugar is in such a tiny amount that it's pretty much insignificant. So not a concern for anybody to rule out the amazing healing benefits of homeopathic remedies. Now, when you mentioned the idea of water, and of course, Dr. Emoto's work comes to mind. And again, today, thanks to work like his and the quantum physics fields and such, we are learning so much about the energetic composition that sort of makes up everything, including us, and how it works and relates. And something else that is interesting when we're talking about the science of homeopathy, in your book, you talk about the idea of silica and how that is also seems to be an important conductor. Can you just touch a little bit upon that?
Sure. And this is very new science that's coming out done in India because the Indian Institute of Technology, it's like in America, we have the National Institutes of Health, they have the Indian Institute of Technology. They're really interested in how homeopathy works. And so they're the ones that have discovered that there are actually what are called nanoparticles, both the recording substance of the remedy and also tiny little particles from the glass bottle that have been somehow shed into. And they think that these tiny nanoparticles, and I should say a nanoparticle is a very tiny particle on one dimension. It's only one molecule or one atom thick. These are being used in conventional medicine now. For example, with chemotherapy drugs, they're finding they can use a small fraction of the drug when they put nanoparticle form, and people don't get the same side effects. So in conventional medicine, they're discovering that nanoparticles facilitate the delivery into the body. And in homeopathic remedies, it seems like this tiny, tiny bit of silica in there, what helps to stabilize the structure of the water? We don't know. This work is still being done. You know, why is it called Silicon Valley? Because computer chips, that's what silica is, what's used to store memory in computer chips.
Right.
I think stuff is going to come out about this, but it's still very preliminary research.
Right. But it's interesting how, yes, there's definitely a connection there to that, you know, technology seems to use the element of silicon, and yet it's also used here somehow in homeopathy. And like you said, I think this is a fascinating field, and even though it's been in the works for over 200 years and successfully practiced and you know, helping to heal people, we have still yet to discover what is it exactly that makes it work, which is so exciting. Now, something else that you mentioned that may be a concern for some is today, as we are learning about nanoparticles or nanotechnology, there seems to be a little bit of controversy in terms of their safety. Is there any such risk with when it comes to the nanoparticles used in homeopathy?
It's totally different. I think what you're talking about is things like nanoparticles of on permanent press clothing, for example, that can get in, like carcinogenic things that can get into
yes.
the body, the product or the substance that's being turned into a nanoparticle that's foreign to the body, that's entering into the body, that's having an effect that's dangerous with those nanoparticles. But in this case, the nanoparticles are of mostly of herbs, you know, simple benign substances and of silica.
Mm-hmm.
And I can also say in terms of safety, these remedies have been used for 200 years completely safely. Nobody has ever died from a homeopathic remedy. You know, we would know by now. It's like conventional drugs. Usually it takes several years.
Yeah.
You know, the rule of thumb is don't take a new drug until it's been out for 7 years, because by then it's decided to come up. Well, with homeopathy, it has been used for 200 years. So we know by now that it's very safe. Safe for kids, safe for babies, safe for animals. Even being used for plants now.
Yes, and you also, in your book, mentioned that even for breastfeeding and pregnant women, and there's so much benefits that can be used there just for the mom to build up her nutrient levels or to have an easier time with childbirth or post-childbirth, etc. So many amazing uses, and again, I think it's good to emphasize for everybody that it is, as I understand it, and maybe you can expand more on this, side effect free. Rather, it has side benefits.
Benefits, right. That's the way I like to think about it. Let's see, it doesn't have side effects in the conventional sense of the term. Sometimes there are effects, like unexpected effects. And one example is that when I give someone a remedy that absolutely is hitting the nail on the head, it's like the perfect remedy for them, not just for the condition they have, but their whole, the trauma they've been through, things about them as a person. Sometimes the first effect is that they go deeply sleepy and they need to sleep a lot. And I tell them it's because their healing energy is so happy to have this information. It's like operating instructions for how to heal, that it's taking all the body's energy. It's like cocooning inside to try to rearrange things or rewrite things or restore things. Very, very occasionally I see that with what we call acute prescribing, and that's kind of household prescribing. I'm thinking of a mom who brought her little boy and he had asthma, so I gave her a remedy, like a chronic remedy, long-term remedy to shift that. In the meantime, he had a cough, so I also gave her a remedy to give him for his cough. He's a little boy, 4 or 5 years old. And I said, to keep giving it every few hours until he got better. Well, she called me. She said he fell asleep as soon as she gave it to him, and she kept trying to wake him up to give him more. And I could tell by that it was like such unusually deep sleep that I said, his body is healing. I said, I bet when he wakes up, cough will be gone, which in fact is what happened. But every now and then I have a parent call in a panic and say, I just drugged my child with that remedy you gave. This happened early, but I have to be honest, sometimes there are effects that to a homeopath are part of the healing.
Yes.
But who doesn't know about it, they could think of it as a negative effect. And then another thing that happened, again, very, very rarely happens with household prescribing. And actually, mostly only happens with what we call hypersensitives, people who are very, very sensitive across the board to environmental chemicals, to fragrances, to dry cleaning fumes, paint fumes, people who will say, if I get a prescription, I don't even tell my doctor. What I do is I cut it in a half, and then I cut that in a half. I only take a quarter because otherwise I get side effects.
Wow.
These are what we call sensitives. People like that actually could get a temporary worsening of symptoms that can be part of the action of homeopathy.
Mm-hmm.
It's really like a side effect. It's like the homeopathic remedy is giving you a little tap on the back. It's like coming up behind you, giving a little tap on the shoulder, saying, go this way to help, this way. You want to go this way, this way, this way. Little
right.
tap, little tap. And I use that image because when it comes to dosage, we want to give a remedy just enough to get the healing process going and then leave it alone, not give more, because that would be like this helpful person coming up behind you and giving a big slap on the back in the right direction, and you stumble and fall. You're pointed in the right direction, but you fell down because it was too much. That's what can happen when the remedy is too strong. They may have heard this about homeopathy. You have to get worse before you get better. It's absolutely not true. It can happen with chronic prescribing. When people go in for like arthritis, diabetes, depression, a long-term thing, most professional homeopaths will give a single dose in the office of a very strong dose that they want to last for several months. And for a very sensitive person, it can make it seems like a side effect. It's not. It's called an aggravation, temporary worsening. Hardly ever happens with home prescribing, and really only with very, very sensitive people.
Mm-hmm. Which makes, you know, I think everybody understand and feel more comfortable about how it works, that there isn't the typical side effects that one would expect from pharmaceuticals. Even if nothing is felt, liver damage is always on some level taking place, because of course the liver has to detoxify all these different chemicals. With homeopathy, there's none of that, because again, it's literally information. And of course, when we talk about information, you also mentioned in your book beautiful ideas about it being like a blueprint, which I think everybody's going to have a better understanding of how this really works. But another question that might be on the minds of many right now is, well, okay, so if it's sugar and information, what else? Now, you already mentioned that there could be herbs. Can you tell us where's the root of the homeopathic medicine sourced from?
Sure. So when it was first developed 200 years ago, it was developed as a way to make the medicines of that time, which were toxic, much less toxic by diluting them. Then the founder of it discovered that by shaking them or potentizing them in a certain way, it made them even more effective than the full strength. So the original medicines came a lot from the herbal formulary of 200 years ago. And so a lot of the healing herbs of the Western healing tradition, going back, you know, from England, Germany, and so forth, were turned into homeopathic remedies. It was brought to the New World, and the people who came, let's say, to North America learned from what we call the Native Americans, you call First Nation people. They took their herbal remedies and made them into homeopathic remedies. Mm. In India, the Ayurvedic herbs of India have been made into homeopathic remedies. And the benefits are they often are more powerful that way. They also, we don't have to worry about herbs going extinct. These wonderful herbs that have been overgathered in a tiny amount and then serve millions and millions of people from this small amount of original, it like multiplies the effect of the original starting substance. So I think about 85% are made from plants, another 10% or so from minerals, some of which were known as, they were used as medicine, like arsenic and mercury, which are fairly toxic, were being used as medicines 200 years ago. And there are other minerals like simple table salt, which is not we wouldn't think of it as a medicine now, but made as a homeopathic remedy. There's something about this energizing process that awakens this almost like the founder of homeopathy called it the inner spirit or essence of the substance. We think of salt in terms of the tears are salty, the tears of grief. We think of things being preserved with salt. And this remedy made from table salt is used for long ago griefs when the person said, I never shed a tear, and they've stuffed it all down and their body is now expressing this unexpressed through physical symptoms of an inert substance, an inert mineral. There are a few other things. Interestingly, for example, x-rays, you can shine an x-ray beam on distilled water, make that into a homeopathic remedy. It will work for the effects of x-rays. Somebody who's been through radiation treatment can be treated with the remedy x-ray or radium, for example. So there are just a few things like that. There's remedy made from sunlight that I successfully use for sun-damaged skin to reverse. So anyway, many, many different possible starting
amazing,
substances.
Amazing. And it's so beautiful to hear. And, you know, when I hear you speak about this, and upon reading your book, the word, there was one word that just kept coming up over and over to me, and that is elegant. It seems like the most elegant design of nature. And all that connects us as one in life that is really being transmitted through these medicines that today we know as homeopathy. And so I, again, for anyone who is has a greater understanding of the energetic nature of life and, of course, is open to natural and alternative healing, I cannot recommend this enough, because I just feel so much in how powerful this is going to be, how it is already, and how it's going to continue to be as more of us awaken to understanding how energy works when it gets transmitted in the qi, you know, whether we're talking Chinese medicine or Ayurveda, you mentioned, etc. Like, these traditions have already known about things like this for thousands of years. And for us here in the West, it seems like, oh, it's new, it's unproven. How is this working? So do you have any practical advice for anyone maybe who gets a hard time from their family? I know in your book, you beautifully describe it in detail. But one short tip maybe to someone who gets some flack about using homeopathics, or maybe to a skeptic.
Sure. I mentioned in my book, my father was my first skeptic because he's a doctor and he's kind of sympathetic, but he struggles to understand it. A few of the things that seem to be effective. Well, one thing is that people say it's unproven, and we can answer to that on multiple levels. One is that there actually is a lot of research on homeopathy. Mm-hmm. Sees most of it not published in English. And of course, it's not in the curriculum of medical schools. And so doctors will often say it's unproven. They don't know any better. One of the themes of my book is to have a respectful dialogue with your doctor. Respect how much they do know, at the same time being aware of how much they don't know, because they simply don't have time. They hardly have time to keep up with their own fields. They don't have time to read outside their fields. Unfortunately, they tend to assume if we don't know about it, it must not be true. Mm-hmm. It cannot work if we don't know about it. Actually, there are whole systems. Acupuncture is another elegant and beautifully developed system that Western doctors don't know about, but it's worked for 5,000 years for a billion Chinese people.
Exactly. You know,
the first answer is that, yes, there is research. The second answer is that we need to stop waiting for things to get the randomized placebo-controlled trial before we use them, especially when the things have been in common usage for 200 years. There has never been a problem. Part of the focus of my book is, why not just go ahead and try it and see if it works for you? I'm trying to empower people to be aware of their bodies, to notice their bodies, to notice what they feel, to notice what makes them feel better, what makes them feel worse. And if it's safe, why not?
Exactly.
It's very expensive to run a trial like that. It takes a long time. There are not funds to run trials like that in America on homeopathy, because the homeopathic pharmacies, usually these trials are paid for by the drug companies. But these products, let's say this little thing right here, this will cost you like $7.95 in a health food store. Generate the millions and millions. It's like $100 million to run a trial.
Yeah.
So it's not the lack of these trials doesn't prove that they don't work. It means that there isn't funding yet. It's, instead of unproven, we should say not yet proven.
Right.
Because if the studies are well designed, then they should demonstrate what we already know, which is that they work. And finally, there are studies which seem to show, with natural healing in general, not just homeopathy, but vitamins, many different things, organic foods, there are studies that purport to show that these things are not effective, they don't work, not worth the money, whatever. Sadly, when you look into it, you often find that these trials have been paid for by people who have a vested interest in disproving.
Exactly.
And that they are able to design the study in such a way. I'll tell you, it's very, very easy to design a study that seems to prove that homeopathy doesn't work. It's when I had a school of homeopathy, it was one of the assignments for the first year students. It was that set up a trial that proves that a remedy doesn't work. Well, it's really easy. You use the wrong remedy for the problem, or you use it not strong enough for the problem, or you only give it once when any homeopath would have given it once an hour for the 2 days or something.
Yes, yes.
It's actually tricky to set it up in a way that it is likely to work. You have to have a good homeopath designing the trial and so forth. So the lack of proof doesn't mean it doesn't work. It's like, it's safe to try. Why not try? And if people do try it, then they know in their heart, if something works for you or for your child, if you have a baby who's screaming with teething pain and you put the little pellet in the baby's mouth and the baby stops screaming, a mother in her heart of hearts knows that it works. In my book, I'm trying to create scenarios where people can try things. They're likely to get good results. They're likely to know for themselves that it will work. And then what can the other person say? If they talk about scientific trials or lack of whatever, it doesn't matter if somebody feels for themselves that it works. In the book, I'm trying to suggest usages that people are likely to get good results. They're likely to feel it right away. There mm-hmm. are, you know, there are other books on homeopathy that have 10 times more information than mine. I culled it down to say, these are the situations where you will see, you know, with the bruise, with arnica. You could do an experiment like my friend, the pharmacist. She used arnica gel. She had a huge bruise. She rubbed it. The arnica on half of the bruise and not on the other half. The half with the gel, the bruise went away. You know, it's like she did her own little experiment.
Yes, that's amazing. And, you know, thank you so much for sharing that. And I appreciate that. And I know so many of our viewers will as well, to really understand the depth of what is going on when it comes to the science or proving, not proving. And how also, unfortunately, we do have for most people today who are into alternative natural health are well educated on what is happening, for example, with pharmaceuticals and why it's not in their best interest for the pharmaceutical companies, for example, to prove that this actually works. I mean, like you said, for $7.95, where's the money in it, right? You can't patent that, etc. So I do hear you that we do have still so much to basically open our minds to not be so quick. Because I find sometimes people tend to be so quick in that almost ignorant sense to just shut something down when they could be exposing themselves to amazing benefits from something like homeopathy. So as we do look at the wealth of resources, which, by the way, is another amazing aspect of your book, that you just give website after website and book after book and videos and teachers and lectures and so many resources in your book that really can empower anyone for years, as I saw it, you know, to really keep going on this journey that, yes, you're one expert, but you say, hey, look, there's all this other stuff that can support you on your journey, which I think is just makes the book well worth it just for that alone. Now, do you have maybe three most important remedies that you'd like to share with the audience that are a must for you in everybody's natural medicine cabinet?
It's hard to limit to three, but I'll try. Number one would be arnica. And especially if you have little kids who are learning to walk or kids who are on a skateboard or a scooter, play football, but really for everybody, arnica is good for bumps, bruises, black eyes, pulled muscles, sports injuries, sprained ankles. Anytime there's soft tissue damage, arnica is going to help reduce the bruising, the swelling, the soreness. I mentioned it even can be used before and after surgery and before and after childbirth, because let's face it, that's rough for both mom and baby. So totally safe for newborns. So arnica would be number one. Number two would be calendula, which is also an herbal remedy. So calendula, it's a little bit stronger as a homeopathic remedy and easier to take systemically when you put it in your mouth. Let's say somebody has a large, God forbid, a large burn, or they have a rash or something all over that it's hard to apply a cream to. Calendula cream works great too. But calendula internally actually works better than applying it externally. And so anytime the skin is broken, a cut, a scrape, an abrasion, a surgical incision, it works great after surgery. I've had many, many reports from clients saying that the scar, the incision healed very quickly. There wasn't a scar. There was so little pain, they didn't need to use any additional pain. Their doctors and nurses were surprised and so forth. Yeah, so calendula would be number two. For number three, I'm going to bring up a new concept, which is called emotional first aid. And that means all of us sooner or later get that phone call that we dread. It could be a car accident. It could be that an elderly parent has passed away. It could be, you know, anything that's upsetting, that's sudden, that's shocking, that's frightening. Little kids will experience this. You know, they may have they may see a scary movie or something. So emotional first aid, it's something that we don't really address in our society because we don't have ways to do it. Other than, of course, teaching your kids to do nice deep breathing, for example, as a way to relax. But my third favorite would have to be Ignatia, which is not the herb echinacea. Echinacea is also great. It's an immune system herb. Ignatia is great for sudden grief, sudden shock. It's also for betrayal, for humiliation, anything that's really upsetting. And of course, you know, if it's a minor incident, you don't need to teach your kids to medicate every little thing that comes along.
Right.
Sometimes, I'm just thinking, for example, I have a child in my practice who had the experience of standing on a neighbor's lawn and watching her family house burn down with her cats inside and had nightmares. She was entitled, I'll say she was entitled to have symptoms from that experience. And that's something that needs help.
Mm-hmm.
And with conventional drugs, you're more kind of numbing the person. With Ignatia, you're strengthening the person. You're strengthening that core of the person that is able to cope, that's able to rise above, that needs to process that grief.
Mm-hmm.
And people to do, you need to help a child or help yourself work through a grief, but you want to be able to strengthen that part of yourself, that inner core part.
Wow, that is really valuable to know. And I'm glad that you also brought in the aspect that it's not, you know, and you've mentioned this in the book, that it's homeopathy does not suppress the symptoms. Because sometimes people might think, oh, so if I'm grieving and this takes it away, that means I'm, what, suppressing it? But it's not at all like the pharmaceutical conventional approach that just you know, let's not think about your symptoms until they, of course, reappear somewhere else in more strength usually. So that's beautiful that you said that it strengthens our system. And that, again, for most of us, we understand that the body has an innate natural healing ability. And it just, you know, homeopathy works with that. That's wonderful, wonderful to know. Can you share also maybe some practical tips? You know, there's so many different brands of vitamins out there. Is there such a risk for buying homeopathy when it comes to the different brands, maybe different strengths? How can we be sure we're getting basically a good thing?
Sure. Well, I actually meant to mention when you asked me about responding to a skeptic, a unique thing about homeopathy in the U.S. is that it's regulated by the FDA as if it's an over-the-counter medication. The FDA is really hands-off with vitamins. It's like the vitamins are somewhat of a Wild West. It's supposed to be self-regulated. But with homeopathy, they inspect every homeopathic pharmacy. They hold them to very, very high standards, very strict regulations about the manufacturer, which means that there really isn't much difference between the different brands. Any brand you get is going to be, you can depend on any brand that you get. There's a slight difference. This brand standard, there's little soft tablets, so if you want to dissolve them in water, it's a little easier. But these are much more common. And most health food stores will have this as their basic. And these are great. Well, wrong, these are great. Let me just show you. To open it, nobody can figure out how to open it. You hold it with a plastic, clear plastic cap on the bottom, and then you twist, and the little white pellets will pop out into the cap. This is so you can then pull off the cap and pop it in your mouth without touching it with your fingers. It's widely believed that touching it with your fingers is not a good idea. I've done experiments because I think there are too many rules about homeopathy. The rules like no coffee, no mint, no don't touch them, no this or that. I find that the rules are an obstacle. So I've been experimenting and I found that the rules do not matter. Mm-hmm. You can put pellets in your hand. You can mix them with food. Sometimes to get them into a kid, you have to put them into food or into a dog or cat. You put them in their cat food. Yeah. They're all beliefs about homeopathy. So to answer your question, any brand is going to be great. Different brands can make different combinations. Like this is a favorite combination, Calms Forte. So it's called the homeopathic Valium. Good for insomnia, good for calming. This brand, Highlands, also makes the teething tablets that I mentioned. Different brands will pick out different, a set of maybe five remedies, say for coughs or for allergies. Different brands will make different combinations. And so if you try one of these combinations and it doesn't work, it means your specific remedy might be in a different combination. It doesn't mean homeopathy doesn't work. It means that that company picked five out of like 50 possible remedies and they happen not to get your remedy. The standard potency in a health food store is 30. And that's, if you look at kind of a bell curve of how people are going to respond, most people will get a good response with a 30. There's on one end of the bell curve, there's a very, very sensitive person. When I say hypersensitive, if people are hypersensitive, they usually know that they want across the board to everything. Those people should try to get a 6 potency, a low potency. They can get it online and a large health food store will have it on hand. 30 is likely to create this, what seems like a side effect. It's not. It's part of the healing, but it feels to the person like their symptoms are getting worse and it's unpleasant, uncomfortable. Very sensitive people can avoid that with a number 6 potency. Now, some people on the other end of the spectrum, and unfortunately, this tends to be the doubting, skeptical husbands. isn't strong enough for, and they're the ones that say, this stuff never works for me. Well, that's probably because the 30 in the health food store isn't strong enough. So what you can do is take a pellet of the 30, put it in water, actually put it in a little water bottle and shake it. Even if you whack the bottle, that will tend to strengthen it. Frequent sips will make it stronger. But some people, I have found this in my homeopathy school, where I have a class of 30 people, maybe one or two of those people can only handle a 6. Mm-hmm. One or two of those people know that they have to get a 200, which is the next strongest one. Not usually in stores, but legally it can be sold online. I would never try that first, but if people try a 30 and it's not strong enough, and they're sure it's the right remedy, then the next thing is to try a 200. People find that from experience. So.
Wonderful to know. And I know you explained more again about understanding and really working with these strengths best in a typical home setting for everyone, again, in your book. Now, another question that, of course, is going to be a big one is, okay, so it might only be about $8 or $10, but let's say I invest in it and I find out it was the wrong remedy, but I may need it at a later point. How do we understand the expiry of homeopathy?
The expiration date is a technicality that exists only for the benefit of the manufacturers because the FDA requires, if they want to put a 10-year expiration date, they have to save some of each batch for 10 years and show that it's still good. They don't want to do that. So they keep, they say 5 years is reasonable. The fact is, it will be good unless you open the bottle and you see the pellets have melted together, or they look, you know, they look like mm-hmm. they're deep somewhere. I actually talked to someone from the FDA about this, because there are historic kits. There are remedies from 200 years ago that people tried that still work. They have to be kept out of high heat. And if you open them, you don't want to have the lid off. This is the one belief about what antidotes homeopathy that I think may be true that I try to be careful with, which is essential oils, aromatherapy oils, Vicks VapoRub, Bengay, things like that. Mm-hmm. I'm too open and exposed to things like that. And I wouldn't even keep it in a medicine cabinet if the medicine cabinet is kind of reeking of these camphor and eucalyptus kind of oils. Those are really the only two reasons that homeopathic remedies might go bad. I wouldn't mm-hmm. keep them in the apartment of your car in the heat of the summer over 100 degrees. But another thing that people believe is that x-rays in the airport will interfere. I've traveled a lot. I've served as trip doctor to many meditation retreats in foreign countries that involved 5 different x-rays in each direction. My kid is fine, so I don't worry either.
Good to know. Wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing that. And so as we wrap up, I know that people might be wondering, okay, so what's my next step? I can either educate myself through resources like books like yours, and of course, there's so many other books and resources that you mention in your book, DVDs, and again, lectures and teachers, where they can learn and practice themselves. And this is, again, one of those things that I would even say in many cases is better than even some experimentation with herbs. Some herbs can actually give more of different types of effects that are undesirable if we don't know what we're doing. But people can also, if they feel more comfortable or have a condition that requires more care or attention, seek a certified homeopath such as yourself. Can you share, for example, with yourself or with others who work like you, do you offer consults in person or over, can it be long distance, internationally? How does that work?
So anything that's chronic, and that's usually considered to be more than 6 months or maybe a year, something that's kind of settled in, kind of taken root in your system, you can't really treat yourself. Mm-hmm. We don't try to treat ourselves. It's like doing psychotherapy on yourself. So for long-term things, you would want to go to a professional homeopath. I think it's best if you can find one nearby, because to create the personal relationship, for homeopathy to work well, you want the homeopath to hold all of you, you know, not just illness, but really you as a person, your life story, your stresses, and your blossoming, your creativity, your soul, everything about you. That can happen energetically really better when you're with a person. So I would really first try to find someone nearby. The best credential for homeopath is Certified Classical Homeopath, and there's a directory. Homeopathicdirectory.com has both the U.S. and Canada. Now, there are people who are very, very good homeopaths who've never bothered to get this credential because they're really busy, and the credential is not a legal license. So there's not much incentive to get it. So I mentioned that in the book. Other ways, a really good way, is simply your local health food store, which is such a great source of information in the community. Ask your local health food store a homeopath who both is getting good results and has a nice bedside manner, one that people mm-hmm. like, have a good relationship with your homeopath. And then there are the National Center for Homeopathy has both the U.S. and Canada. Homeopathic.org has a directory. The limitation of that is that anyone can declare themselves a homeopath without any, there's no qualifications, credentialing, or training. It's just self, you know, like, hi, I'm a homeopath. Definitely, if you're going that route, I would really look at the person's website, try to find out more about them. I look for someone who's been in practice for a long time. And I look for someone who really focuses on homeopathy rather than, for example, there can be a chiropractor who's taken a course in homeopathy and has learned what remedies to give for joint pain or something. And they may list homeopathy as one of their modalities, but they're not real apt in terms of, you know, treating with, that's their modality. Same thing with naturopaths. Naturopaths are great with vitamins and herbs and diet, but they may have had a little smattering of homeopathy in school and kind of do it as a little adjunct, like really just use the things that you get from a health food store. You want somebody who really focuses on homeopathy.
Great advice. Well, thank you so much. And of course, for anyone who is lucky to be in the Massachusetts area, they can definitely contact you and actually take advantage of seeing you in person. And so, Burke, as we wrap up, thank you so very, very much for everything that you've shared. Like I said, your information, your experiences, obviously a deep wealth of knowledge, and your book clearly reflects that. So thank you for all that. And for anyone who is interested in learning more about Burke and her work, exploring some of the different resources, I recommend to start on greenhealing.org. So greenhealing.org is Burke's website, and from there you can find all the different resources, learn more about Burke. So Burke, just to finish off, is there any one last piece that you'd love to just leave the audience with?
Well, my book is available at Indigo Chapters in Canada and Barnes & Noble and many stores in the U.S. and on Amazon, of course. And I'm really encouraging people just to dip your toe in the water and just try, because, you know, it's completely safe. It's natural. It's been around for 200 years. With the things in my book, you're likely to get good results, and you'll feel so good about yourself. I like to see healing in the home for common household things return to, you know, home care, which is the way for thousands and millions of years people have taken care of common ailments in the home. And I think we need to start doing that again.
Absolutely. Well, wonderful advice. So thank you so very much again for being with us today.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. And thank you, everyone, for joining us. And until next time.